in a moment. All right, we need to call the board, please.
Judy Nelson?
Here.
Tom Clark?
Here.
Emily Leach? Andrea Anderson? Erin Kavanaugh?
Here. Stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, are there comments by visitors on any agenda items? Seeing no comments by visitors, we will move on to the consent calendar. Consent calendar consists of December 14th minutes. Excuse me, after our last school board meeting and the February enrollment.
There's consent calendar, that's right.
Any discussion? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Announcements. I'm going to take the first crack at announcements here so some of people know who all the faces are at the table. We have new faces at the table and at least one person sitting in a new place. So we welcome Lori Lane as our new acting interim superintendent. For those of you who don't know, Dr. Brown resigned effective the last day of 2017 due to personal and family reasons. In her resignation letter, she called RGS an educational gem with wonderful staff and amazing students. And we as a board will miss her and we wish her well. We're very grateful to Lori for stepping into her new role. She was, and I guess still is, assistant superintendent who is now taking on the duties of the superintendent as well. And she'll be doing double duty. We hope to do what we can to help her in the next 6 months that go as smoothly as possible. Which brings me to the next announcement. In case you missed it in the paper, Dr. Bob Grunowski will start July 1st. We reached agreement with him over the vacation period at the end of the year. And he will be starting out. And Lori has already reached out to Dr. Grunowski, and he will be her phone friend. For the next 6 months. We'll finish the faces and then I'll see if Lori has anything of any interest we'd like to say. Katie Krause, who used to sit here, is now sitting in the audience in Marie's old seat because she is now the new Marie. And the new face at the table is Melinda Sullivan, who is taking Katie's old seat. there are little slips in everyone's program. Who's playing his part as we go? So, Lori, do you want to say anything before I do the next bit?
Sure. Lori Lane, the acting superintendent for the next 6 months, actually probably close to 5.5 at this point.
She's not counting.
No, I'm not counting. It's been a whirlwind, I would say. It's not until you go into a job that you really start to really learn what those roles are. I mean, I became certified as a superintendent back in March. Now I'm living the role, and it's exciting work. I'm really excited to work more closely with Katie as well as the board. I would agree with Dr. Brown. RGS is a really neat place. I've been in the building a number of times, and looking forward to working more closely with Katie. We've worked on a number of projects. And anything that I can do to help support. And, as Judy said, I have been in touch with Dr. Gadonsky. I'm used to saying that. It doesn't quite roll off the tongue. He's very very excited to come in. Hopefully, you know, everyone was, we're very excited to have that decision made. And you know, he and I have talked about it already, so hoping that this 6 months timeframe can help to transition and so he can hit the ground running. So, yeah, I'm excited to be here, and I think it'll go by quickly. They're busy days.
Thank you. So just a couple other items. Some people have already asked about filing dates for school board seats that are open, school district moderator, and school district clerk. The filing dates are January 24th. They open January 24th, and they close February 2nd. So people who are interested, we have two seats that are up, and folks are going to re-up, but they're going to sign up to run again. They need to sign up in that time frame at the SAU office.
Treasurer as well.
And treasurer. Sorry, thank you. You know, I knew I was missing one when I wrote it down. Thank you.
Good job.
24th. And the SAU office closes at 4 p.m. Just so people know. And so the last bit, we're going to, Charlie Putnam's here tonight. He is our school district moderator. And he thought he likes to come and attend a meeting usually. And so we're going to open up this part of the meeting to sort of have a conversation with Charlie, if he's interested in talking about anything or just filling us in on how he thinks things are going to go on the 3rd.
All right. Thank you for inviting me to meet with you. Do you want me to stay here or come?
Come up. Do what's comfortable for you. We have a chair here. We have.
If you don't mind.
Yeah.
My hearing is not what it was. When you attend moderators training, they say always meet with the relevant boards before the deliberative session or the town meeting to try to get a sense of where people think the sticking points are, to get agreement on procedures and to get feedback on anything different that you'd like the moderator to do. So I came with some questions, but I'm also happy to discuss any questions or concerns that let's see. So we'll start with my questions.
Why don't we
the board? Okay, let's do that. how does the board feel that the practice of having members of the board introduce warrant articles is going? Do you like that or do you not like that?
I like it because we are the ones who know it best. We've lived it for a number of months working on some particular budget items. So I like it a lot.
It's been done that way for several years. Yeah. It was not done that way for most of the time that I was not a moderator. And my impression as a voter was that it was helpful to have somebody open up the conversation by explaining what the warning is about.
And we will try to keep it brief. And I've got a dry run on Saturday.
Good. Okay. Historically, the board has divvied up the warrant articles for introduction. Or last year, I think one of you introduced the budget and you did the rest.
That could be.
However you want to do it is fine. It's helpful to me to know who to introduce as the person who's going to sponsor.
We haven't discussed that yet, and we'll let you know who's going to be introduced.
That's perfect. And I don't think there are any warrant articles by petition issued.
Not yet coming yet. I think it's called
the 9th.
Right?
The 9th was the last.
The 9th was the last day, so there will be no petition warrant articles.
And for a couple of years, I have asked members of the grade school to lead us in the pledge. Any concerns about that practice?
We don't have any concerns about it. We have to continue with it.
It's nice to get the kids involved and to, for us as voters to get a visual reminder about what this is all about. So, okay? Here's where the pop quiz comes up. I have a fairly extensive list of moderator rules, and I won't ask you to recite them to me, but do you have, as you sit here, do you have any questions or concerns about how I can run this? how I move things in or out, how I set the boundaries. Again, it's the moderator's rule, both the rules and the rulings can be overturned by a majority vote of the persons present in the room session. So it's not like they're cast in stone. But, okay, so I'm good with that.
That's good. And we will remind you, we will have council presidents.
That, I was going to ask you that.
They're figuring out who's going to be.
Right, yeah, there's a number of, I guess, sessions that day. So the Barbara thought.
She's here a few times.
So that's helpful because one of the questions that sometimes comes up in a deliberative session, the scope of amendments is, it does have legal ramifications for the district. It's most important on bonding issues, as I understand it, but even on regular warrant articles, it's helpful to have something there. You know, have a second set of eyes on my movements, what's in, what's out. The basic rule is that the underlying intent of a warrant article can't be changed by the amendment. And again, sometimes that comes down to words with the amendment. Okay, and I'm almost at the end of my questions. This last year, I included sort of a moderator's orientation to how I plan to run the meeting. It takes up about 3 minutes, I think. Again, if the board would prefer to get to the business of the meeting quicker, I can omit that orientation. If you think it's helpful to voters,
I would just make the suggestion offered. It's not meant to be written form.
Could be.
If anybody has any questions, I need just to move that form.
It's not like I'm a new moderator anymore, so we put into three of these things to
get. Yeah, so.
By way of information, there's been some dispute in the state, particularly among moderators, between moderators and the Secretary of State, about the exercise of authority under statute to delay elections, which did affect the school district because you had a number of bonding issues as well as your budget on the election.
We did not. The school district did not have any bonding issues. No, the town
that had all those bonds.
Yep.
So maybe it doesn't really affect you. There is pending legislation that would largely would set a standard that a town moderator can request that the Secretary of State delay a local election if the moderator can prove that it would be impossible to delay an election. And impossible. the standard would be the personal whim of the Secretary of State. The word impossible is not defined in the statute. The statute uses the phrases imminent danger. Public safety, there's another qualifier in there. If that were the standard, it would be, arguably there's a legal standard there, but the word in the statute is impossible. That it's imminent danger and impossible to hold elections. And my view is there's no way to meet that standard other than by select. And this was the Secretary of State who, that blizzard resulted in the declaration that we were a disaster zone, or at least parts of Carroll County were a disaster zone. And he said, no, we never delay elections. I have a point of view about it. I've spoken with the select board about it. I will weigh in as a moderator, but not on behalf of the
team. Oh, I see.
If you have concerns about the taking that position, you feel strongly that the Secretary of State really should be the person making this call.
No, in the grand tradition of New Hampshire, I believe in local rule in this case. I like to pick and choose, but in this case, definitely. Local control. Really. A couple of roads are closed.
Well,
thank you for that.
That's really, that's going to be another issue. This happens again around here. And I think that, you know, a lot of people in jeopardy. So again, my question is, what is the standard? What is our standard?
We have a process. The process is that the moderator, by statute, is directed to confer with local officials, including road agent, the chief of police. So it's a collective decision. The current statute, I think, directs us to imminent danger to public safety.
Well, let me ask you this. Let's say that in the morning, the schools are closed. I mean, they're closing the schools.
Was true last year, Tuesday.
Based on that assumption, that is dangerous for people. So, I mean, it just seems, I guess we should all know what we're doing, but what we're looking at, 3 inches of snow, 4 inches of snow, is, you know, no, but I'm just saying,
but,
because really,
it's true, and I'm comfortable that there's a group of people making the decision. The police know what all the roads are like. They're out there patrolling all the time. The road agent who has to know if the roads are open or not is out there taking care of them. Whether or not there's electricity, the police chief would be able to know those kinds of things. So
the polls open at 7 o'clock. So
right.
Throughout the day, conditions get worse. So how
it's a good
sometimes
point.
They get better. I don't think there is a clear bright line rule based on school closings. And in fact, the concern that the Secretary of State has is that we would become too casual about postponing elections. And I understand that. But I don't think there is much question about last March or the safety, in addition to the safety of voters, the safety of poll workers, many of those persons are volunteers. So I have strong feelings about it, but. Again, I'm going to take here respectful of the process and not put Rollinsburg's head in the room, so to speak, and say, that's all I have, so I don't want to take up too much.
No, thank you. I appreciate that you're taking seriously the meeting with the boards before the deliberative session. I think it's something that we've missed in the past. But this year, there is nothing controversial.
Oh.
Well, the warrant articles, well, I see, you're right, anything controversial can come up, but we are very straightforward. There are three money warrants, essentially, and we hope they're very straightforward. We'll see, won't we?
Okay.
Never. Say never. Thank you. No, well, we'll see. Thank you very much, Charlie.
Thank you all very much.
We'll see you the third. Otherwise, you'd be announcing the announcements. We pulled it it out once because there's no place to put the letters from the cell system.
There's nothing that comes to mind as far as specifics to the school. I will say, Katie knows about this as well, that we did receive from the state information on NeoGov. Discuss that in your discussions around the when that money will be available.
No, we don't know anything about it. We're waiting for someone to tell us about when money might be available. We love hearing when it's available.
So that's something, you know, for school districts, you know, you've heard about, you know, the votes taken around putting machines in various communities in order to raise funds and help support full day kindergarten. And we were under the impression that those funds would not be available until the 2019-20 school year. Well, we received a communication last week saying that it will start at 18-19 for districts that offer full day kindergarten. So we're looking to, you know, move forward with trying to, you know, make that available. We have some work that we need to do by the end of the month. Not significant amount of work, but that was a little bit of a surprise.
That's good news, and actually, David Waters, our senator, had said that to me about 6 months ago, that it would be available this year, but we had received no official word, so, but that's wonderful news. I mean, anytime the state wants to give us money, we are.
Right, it seemed like a good service.
I hope it's a good thing for us.
Right, so it's an $1,100 per student amount. So it's not a small money, but at least. So we'll continue to work on that and
excellent. Thank you. And keep us informed as that goes along. That's very good news. Well, if you're only going to share good news,
that's okay.
Perfect.
So that's all
I'm going to start out great.
Oh, yeah.
That's good communication. That's for every community. Wonderful. Thank you. Discussion items. We're going to start with the principal updates.
Given that we've had six school days since the last, I did not submit one because we've had six school days since the last principal's update and nothing changed since the last one.
Yeah, there was a small boiler incident over the holiday, and you wanted to share how that got taken care of?
I guess I will start with how grateful I am to have Mr. Fordier on staff for this. So as you know, we've had boiler issues my whole time here. He makes a really concerted effort to watch our boilers at all times. And so there's eight circulator pumps, which are very important for circulating the water through our building. And we've had one that's been on its way out for a significant amount of time. He's been really paying really close attention to it, and it actually went over vacation. Which if he hadn't been really paying close attention to it, he never would have known over vacation and wouldn't have had heat. So he spent long days and long nights here over vacation, getting the parts in, which had to be special people because our boilers are a little bit older, and installing himself, getting the building back up and running so that when we returned, every classroom had heat, whereas over vacation, there was missing nearly half of the building. So it was just great to have him on staff that's so knowledgeable about it and so aware of that. Had it been me, you know, 3 or 4 years ago, I wouldn't have it. We would have come back from vacation, and it would have been a total disaster given that it was negative 15 degrees in Churchill. So it's really nice to have someone with that expertise and that pay so close attention and how it costs us a fraction what it could have potentially cost us had he not been here to be so diligent.
Well, thank you. That really was helpful. And I also understand that on these cold days, you can hold like sock hops and things for the kids because it's too cold for them to go out.
That's Mrs. Powers, our kindergarten age.
Okay.
It's wild, it's fun.
Well, good. All right.
Thank you for letting me know.
Yeah. Right now, they're having a blast in the snow. Like, it is, like, being on a sunny hill or ski snowball, it's so much fun for them right now.
There'll be a lot of wet coats for the parents. Thank you, Kate. Noah Nijikowski got in touch with me a little bit earlier this evening. He is in the midst of midterm exams and felt that he could not come this week, so he's not here this evening for an update. We'll wait for him for next month. But Bailey, the Summersworth student rep is here, so Bailey, your update, please.
So our student council has their winter snowball dance on this
14th, 7 to 10. We're taking advantage of the long weekend. Just a nice dance from there. We're making this a big event. We really want to increase school spirit this year. And so we're making this a big party with some games and contests. We have a student who's really into DJing. He's into DJing. So yeah, we have like a student DJ who comes in. He's very into it. He has like banners made and everything like that. So we're really trying to talk about and create a nice positive morale throughout the school and just increase that school spirit. We also have our annual Mr. SHS pageant on February 3rd. And this is when a group of 12 or so senior boys battle it out for the title of Mr. SHS. Our National Honor Society chapter is working on getting a Keys Reader's Day where we can go home. And then we're also volunteering at a hockey game UNH tomorrow night and volunteering at the kitchen next Wednesday. And then we are taking 7 students and 2 chaperones to attend a national conference in Washington, D.C. on January 25th. And this has been a long time coming. We've put so much work into it, so it's great to see everything kind of come together in like 2 weeks, which is insane.
And this is a National Honor Society conference?
Yeah, so it's a National Honor Society conference. And it's actually also for student councils too, so we'll get to see kind of all different dynamics at the conference, but we're all very excited. For our classes, our freshman class is holding their annual March Madness fundraiser, which is a senior versus staff basketball game to raise money for their class, and that'll be on March 16th. The sophomores are planning Valentine's Day dance. The juniors are working on their annual prom fashion show fundraiser, which is a huge fundraiser for prom, so they're working really hard on that, and that's February 3rd from 2 to 4 p.m. And the senior class is just working out project grad details, and we have senior shirts that join here and coming in next week, which is exciting. Our art club is a new club this year. It's actually working on a mural throughout the CTC of our school, so they've been staying after school every day to work on little ceramic tile pieces that anyone can come in and they can have like some input, and they can make their own mark in the hall of our high school, which is really awesome. They're just doing the finishing touches on that. It's so cool to walk by. And then our finals will be January 23rd.
Thank you. Thank you. And as usual, you are invited to stay, but we also know that you're a busy person who has lots of new things to look forward to.
Yeah.
So you're not invited to stay. You may leave whenever you are ready.
Thank you.
The next piece on our agenda is the first reading of a long list of policies. I forgot to bring my copy so far. Because, sure, that'd be great. Thank you. I don't know if people have had a chance to look through them. I know I had notes on a couple of them. This is not the entire list that people was reviewing in November. Quite a few people took it out. Quite a few, 4 or 5. But Don Austin and I reviewed that in November to see what we were going to each of our boards, and these are the ones we brought for the year. So I don't know if anyone's had a chance to look through them.
I did a little quick reading.
Yeah.
I had some questions on some of the plans. Are we supposed to? So I noted that it, like the emergency plan.
School board. See, when I call her, it didn't happen, but it actually has a few more contents. Well, the superintendent is responsible for ensuring that at least 2 times a year the district conducts emergency response drills. The board will review this policy annually. So what they mean is this policy.
Okay.
I believe. Does anyone have a different understanding of that?
The one question she's asking is about the board review. And I think it means
this policy, right?
Not the plan, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I don't think we get input anymore.
I didn't think so.
It was a good question.
I wasn't aware that we had a character
assistant,
and I'm like, wow, well, it's
starting doing that. That's great.
The parent parents. It's required.
Yes, I did.
It may be new.
It may be new. I don't know.
There is a review in that one. So it's the second paragraph.
Those in charge, those in charge. Oh, okay, yes.
I see, yep. And so it does look like, no, it's very good, very good.
It's required by law.
I actually think it is new. I'm not sure. Again, I don't have my cheat sheet to tell you if it's new, which one's new.
Yeah.
So it looks like we do have a student discipline and new process.
I think we do.
Yes.
Right, so it's really teacher and principal discretion. And I guess we just had a question if that is typical. Is that typical of teacher, principal at the school? I mean, I'm bringing this board because a question was asked me. Should there be policies according to what? I mean, it talks about a student being removed from the classroom in detention at the discretion of the teacher.
Well, it's a good question as to policies are here, of course, to protect everyone, students, teachers, administrators, everyone. Things that happen at a building level usually happen at a building level. Well, certainly ask Lori and Kate, if you want to weigh in on this, that student discipline, our policy states that it's handled by...
I talked about the teacher, discretion of the teacher and principal. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I guess the question of that's typically what is that typically what is done?
I've never heard it any other way. In any school, it always starts within the classroom, or if it's not a classroom teacher, it might be whoever's on recess duty, the teacher that's in that particular space or that, you know, class or field trip or something like that, usually starts there. Most often that doesn't make it to them as well unless it's a significant incident. So, you know, starts there. And oftentimes, sometimes they're leaving the room, it's within the room. So yeah, there are sometimes I see kids, and it's usually because they've needed four reminders from an adult and it's time to stop and talk to me and we'll be more serious.
If you have specifics that you could do, I do feel pretty good about the report and we can talk about whether they're appropriate to have in a policy or not.
Yeah, I don't really know that it's board level. I mean, I know that I know of more of a building level policies that have more specific guidelines than just the discretion of the teacher, for sure. And I don't know that RJS has one of those or not, but I don't know that it's the board's
I believe we do have policies that become more specific and about physical restraint. And I know we have some on physical restraint and things like that. Those are required by law. They're not here because they're not having a change in their
program.
Right, right. But they are.
I just want to offer a point of clarity. Physical restraints are never a consequence. Ever. It is not discipline.
No, I'm just saying we have policies because of state law, we have policies talking about.
Yes, absolutely.
That's all I'm saying.
I'm sorry.
Is something like just randomly, arbitrarily, like if a teacher, you know, is it a board level issue to discuss whether the school should have a guideline such as if a teacher has to, you know, correct a student on the same thing five times, they go to the principal. Again, totally arbitrary.
Typically, it would not.
It would not.
I mean, I think it's more like what I find in a lot of policies is that you will have procedures, that you will describe, that there are structures that you need to put into place. And then it's up to the buildings to make those decisions around what those things are. You know, when you think about schools that adopt like a PDIS or a
that wasn't.
And boys don't get involved in that.
Typically not. I think typically your role is that there's, you know, it's risen to the point of, you know, maybe a significant discussion or some kind of disciplinary action that's very significant.
I don't need to.
We have enough going on.
Oh, lots of things.
Other things that caught people's eye? This is our first read through, our first discussion. We'll have another opportunity.
I said we had an educational surveys and relationships policy.
That was interesting since we've done those the past couple of years.
Yes, we haven't done those with students though, so that was.
But it's not.
Well, it says that you can't.
Or guardian.
Has, right, you have to have permission in order to survey students.
Yeah, no, I was just thinking, we did do a non-educational survey.
Yeah.
Right.
Of parents and students and.
Again, I didn't.
It looks like we followed all of our.
It did.
Jen, I think that's a new one. I don't.
That's nice.
Yeah, isn't that great?
It's great.
We're just, that was a good one.
Well, phew, you didn't ask the students.
Yeah, so. We'll take a few more minutes because this, there were a lot there. And we delayed the first read until after the holidays. Instead of doing it in December, we're doing it now.
I'll go back and look at my notes for the.
I did have one other question. And it's really just being curious. I was, when that, the health education. Oh, no. I don't take that one.
IHA.
Wouldn't have taken it.
Health and sex education exemption?
I was just, okay.
Health education exemption for this one. Yep.
So, are we required, does that mean we're required, all schools are required to provide health education and?
It is not a yes.
And gym?
It is not a yes.
This is how we all manage. In a grade school, health can be taught by a classroom teacher or physical education teacher. As the children are older, middle school and high school, it has to be a highly qualified certified teacher in the area of health and wellness. That is not the case in our grade school. It just does English or math. It's in grade school can be taught just by a classroom teacher.
Others? That's all, but I will read my notes before the next time, too, so I can chime in. Thank you. All right, we're moving on to discussion of the deliberative session. This is our last meeting before. We have a meeting Saturday, which is the Budget Committee's public hearing of the school budget. And then a few weeks after that, on February 3rd, we have the actual deliberative session that so we have preparation we need to do for that. And I think our sort of our community outreach people look to continue a lot of that. Yes. Yeah, so is the board, is there someone here on the board who can take that on? Lining up childcare?
I already started that. I talked to staff members about February 3rd. There's a couple staff members that have offered to do it. We have another staff member with 15 daughters who might be willing to help out. So we'll have the deliberative section covered. I did not think about watching tonight. I did not take the lead on doing this Saturday until you contacted me the other day. So we're still working on that, but I had to take the lead as well.
No, it's not a school district meeting, so
we're still working on trying to find people, and I posted it on Facebook, and we'll see if we can get some maybe teenagers or parents to do this one to help.
Well, thank you for your efforts. That's really good. Obviously, you know, we'd love like to have as many people come as possible.
Dog care, the little reception station.
Oh, that's great, thank you. There.
Well, that's, check.
Wow, we're check.
The other thing too is the, you know, you want them to see the yellow weeded signs outside. If our placards on these outside.
Yes. Thank you. Good. And I, now, I know we're doing things online, we're doing Facebook, we're doing other things online, we're asking questions, there are other things that we're doing, I think we're all trying to back up a bit. Do we want to try to email? And we can have an informal discussion on some of this stuff after Saturday's meeting, please.
Or do we want to consider posting the library to the town hall, you know, the website?
Rather than mailing.
Rather than doing another expensive mail.
I feel like not doing the mailing.
So it sounds like my consensus that we'll put together a mail, and I can sort of take the lead on that and possibly with someone like Aaron. Maybe that sounds great. And also, I think we all know here, yes, of course we all know here at Edinburgh, it's called those teachers that are warned right now. We successfully completed negotiations. Representatives were very clear that they'd like to work and help get information out and help people get informed. So we'll find ways to work together on some of that. So what other? Who's going to
take the lead?
I don't know. That's something I will sort of do an email, and I was hoping that one of the folks here from the communication group could name that to be a liaison so that they can. I'm putting your name next to that, Emily.
So we'll create a mailer, we'll do the MVP signs. Yes.
Well, the three of us will be last year.
Is that okay?
As a subcommittee, I believe, right. I think, yes. Oh, well, actually, well, technically, you're formed, it really should be two of you.
But,
okay. Yeah, that's right. That was before that. I'm sorry, that was before
your time, Erin. So, no, Erin came, but she wasn't yet a board member.
Oh, so that was wasn't that painful? Is that what you talked her into becoming?
Yes.
Nice work. Well done.
All right, then we'll figure that out.
You figure figure that out. They'll be like a round ball. And actually, officially, as long as no decisions are made, you can discuss things. And then we have to post something where decisions are made.
Because I need to get more thought, I guess.
Yeah, and I think that's true. I just wanted to get the ball rolling and have you start thinking, because February 3rd is closer than we think.
Yeah.
3 weeks old. So it always creeps up on me. I don't know why. Okay, so I think this is a very good start. We'll want to go along. And again, planning can happen. Laid out the room for the bed and take the action. So, there you go. All right, thank you all. Action items. We do have an action item this evening. Our elected school district clerk will be unable to attend the deliberative session. So I reached out to a young man who did it last year, Corey Jones, who filled that position, and he agreed to fill it again. So by statute, we can name a replacement. So I will entertain a motion for someone to name Corey Jones to be our school district clerk for February.
Nope, there's one for property liability on board.
Okay. So, good experience here. So, my personal recommendation, my chair's recommendation to the board is that we, that we accept this. Sign the feeder contract. It's never been more than 7 board days. And it has, come up less than that. So, a discussion?
Is there any other vendor that has this or this?
No.
That's what I've been called from the last.
So, we accept the offer from the only vendor we can. We have a second. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I will sign these together to you again. Is there any new business? Old business. The FAQs are going on. Right now they're up at the, on the SAU website. Are there any closeouts?
I posted on the Facebook. I posted at least one.
Yeah, one. Do we have any idea who it would be? I'm just curious. Was it?
Do you guys have analytics on that?
Wait, did you see the Linda's eyes?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't think we have anything that tracks.
You can use Google Analytics, like you don't have to have a special system at all. Google will do it all for you. So your IT may have that already. If not, it's like, it would be great to know. But for your comments on Facebook, I cannot see anything on the system. Rightfully, I might know. I didn't see any, but I know it.
Maybe we'll be talking about more FAQs to get out.
I think when we have more, we'll be more excited.
What do we have now? True, and I think as we get some that are going to relate to the warrant articles, like the collective bargaining agreements.
Okay, so it gets more exciting.
More exciting.
More exciting, yes.
Yep.
That is the way.
So,
do we have a next one planned?
No, but I assume that it would have things to do with.
Yep. Okay. Sounds good. That sounds good. Marshall contract items are just moved to add at this point. And by that, we mean things that we're going to be discussing with Marshall. Whether we start the discussion this year or wait till.
Oh, I do have a question about some of the policies. Do they offer coach? One of our policies is that we're required to provide college level students or people of them.
That's an excellent question. So that really should do.
I've seen offerings.
Yeah.
They did. Yes. They had to have a long time.
So they do, so we don't have to check with them. I know there's an update that you sent along here. Do you want to just give an update to everyone on the late start meetings that you attended at the board and or got?
As you know, I was unable to attend the last meeting, the late start group. However, they did forward some notes to me and what they discussed and what was the resolution of that meeting. Basically, they came up with three choices or considerations that they're looking into for March. They're either looking at keeping the current schedule, move the start time back to 7:45, and I guess this was what it was a few years ago, a number of years ago.
7:30.
7:30. 7:35, maybe it's only 10 minutes.
Yeah, 10:30.
7:35.
Yeah, I don't know why that would apply, but.
As you all know, your students are at all times.
7:30.
They have to be at the middle school at 7:20, I know that.
It's a bell.
Time to start, so.
7:30, I believe, so. Move the start time to 8:30 is the other option that they're considering, which would result in a big master change in their course schedule. Now, they're gonna go forward, you know, I guess getting feedback from the high school leadership team, and then the athletic director is also gonna consider impact as well on athletics. Their goal as a group will to come to a consensus and then create a survey to vote the community. So I think there's still a lot. Now, I didn't attend this meeting, but there's still a fair amount of discussions and work to be done. But I will, and the next meeting, late start meeting, is Monday, January 29th at 3:00.
Like the same number of hours?
Well, that is one of the things I did not mention, that they want to keep at Marshman as a 7-hour student day, and they would like to keep that. A number of schools have reduced their school day. I wanted to mention the next meeting, like I said, is at 3:00. I'm going to make every effort to attend that meeting, but if anyone on this board would like to attend, or they can forward the notes to me, I just, 3:00 is a difficult time for me now. January 29th.
Yeah. I know, Archie.
Keep us informed. I think that's starting. I see they're presenting to their board on February 28th to the Marshwood School Board, so. And it sounds like we'll have plenty of warning if they decide to go in any direction. So. Thank you. I appreciate your work on that. All right, we're up to future meeting dates. So, the Budget Committee's public hearing on the public budget and bond meeting is 9:00 this coming Saturday, a few days from now, on the 13th. The 16th is a snow day. If you can't get it in, it's supposed to be warm. We're supposed to have a lot of rain before then. It should be warm, so it should be able to get it done on Saturday. February 3rd, a scant 2 weeks from then, is the deliberative session, which also will be held here at Oxford Grade School, with a snow day of the following Tuesday on the evening, if the weather then is bad.